Yeah, we're live.
Okay. Stage, take it away.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and to everyone who has joined us via social media. I'm Joan Healy Horton, and on behalf of the pastor, Pastor Joshua Dianerine, and the entire church family of Sharon Seventh-day Adventist Church, yes, we are located at 115 South Fifth Avenue, Mount Vernon, New York. We welcome you to Impact. This digital platform is designed to provide coping strategies and bring hope and courage to all during these times of crisis and also beyond. This is a time, ladies and gentlemen, when men's hearts are failing them for fear of both the known and the unknown. But 1 Timothy 1 and verse 7 reminds us that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. This is a time, ladies and gentlemen, when everybody, all inhabitants of all ages in the lifespan, in all the world, for the very first time in history, is having the same concerns for the same reasons, the same problem, and is seeking the same solution. This is also an opportune time for discerning who is really in charge. A time when God is calling many to rest and safety. We hope that as we seek to share spiritual, physical, psychosocial, and financial coping strategies through Impact, that you will be empowered and equipped to find hope and courage in a seemingly crippling environment. Joining me in this forum this evening, ladies and gentlemen, is Dr. David Newton and Dr. Oswald Thomas. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
They will be introducing our guests and leading us through the session as we continue discussion on mental health, examining the psychology of human behavior in moments of increasing stress while seeking supportive measures and coping mechanisms in the process. Let us pray, ladies and gentlemen. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we come to you with heartfelt gratitude for your love, your mercy, and your grace towards us. Thank you for spirit life, Lord. Irrespective of the anxieties, the fears, the challenges that surround us, you have reminded us that we should not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the pestilence that walks at noonday. Are our refuge and strength. There are those, Lord, that are brokenhearted because they have been impacted negatively by this vicious enemy, COVID-19. Your children are experiencing great pain and suffering by loss of loved ones and also loss of basic resources to continue maintaining their families. Mental and physical health is failing, and your people, Lord, are devastated. Please provide comfort in the midst of this disastrous storm. We beseech you, Lord. We pray your continued blessings, protection, peace, health, and care for all those who are working assiduously to help to save and maintain lives. Those who provide food and basic amenities, transportation, safety. Those emergency and immediate frontline personnel, Lord. Medical and allied staff at the various institutions at the risk of their own lives and that of their families, providing preventative, curative, and tertiary services to prevent and control the spread of this seemingly invincible virus. May the Ministry of Impact left footprints in the sands of time as we collaborate our efforts to help those in need. Thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering our prayers. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, Impact with Drs. Newton and Thomas.
Thank you so very kindly, as always, our dear Sister Thornton. Thank you for those of you who have taken the time to join. I am indeed honored to have in our midst again our dear lovely sisters, Neville and Chocola. Thank you, ladies, for taking the time out of your busy schedule to contribute to this ministry. And of course, Resident Dr. Thomas, for your expertise and skills. All three of you combined will assist us in dealing with how do we navigate these waters of hysteria and fear and maintain mental health. We had a very good start last week, and I am happy that we're going to round it off today. I am going to impress upon you to mute your phones if you are not speaking. Until then, we will, because we're hearing some background noise. We are going to jump right into it because we want to maximize our time, okay? Our first question will go to our ladies. Sister Neville, and you are a senior mental health specialist with a major concentration in rehabilitation and counseling, and your current facilitator, Sister Chocola, she's a licensed mental health therapist, and she is also certified in the drug rehab counseling specialties. And we are very happy to have you both. So I'm gonna start with Sister Chocola because we were trying to tap into some of this last week, but we didn't have time. Sister Chocola, because I know from my practice, there are a lot of patients that come in who are asking for Xanax and Zoloft and the Adderall and these medications. They're those who come and get it from the doctors and they get it legally. But there are others who abuse drugs and who have a tendency to do that as a coping mechanism. Of course, it becomes a dysfunction. How does drug abuse affect a person's mental health from your perspective, especially in the area of drug rehab? Talk to that issue for us, Sister Chocola.
Yeah, so there's definitely an interplay between substance abuse and mental health. Oftentimes there's conversations around which one comes first, like what the chicken or the egg, right? So is it that a person has mental health concerns and mental illness that leads to the likelihood of using substances? Or is it that sometimes when a person uses substances, there's the development of mental health? Both of those things are plausible, right? So typically there are different mental health issues that can result from using substances, such as a greater likelihood of depression, a greater likelihood of anxiety, a greater likelihood of just overall mood disorders, right? A greater likelihood of issues with memory and aggression as well. Substances can significantly impact the development and the exacerbation of some of these issues. So say, for instance, a person already had depression, already had anxiety, for instance, incorporating substance abuse into that makes it a bit harder to manage some of those symptoms of those diagnoses.
Okay. So from your expert opinion, would you say that the drug abuse comes before a dysfunctional mental health, or would you say they go hand in hand?
I think they go hand in hand, okay. Right? I would venture to say that typically, oftentimes what you'll find is that people tend to self-medicate in other ways before they realize that they have a substance abuse issue, right? Yep. You have people who talk about having their occasional happy hour, right? Without realizing that you're dealing with negative emotion by utilizing a substance to do that, right? And over time that could become a prolonged issue. So, you know, again, it's hard to say, but I think they definitely go hand in hand in terms of mental health impacts the likelihood of using substances, because you find that most individuals who use substances are 2 times as likely to have a mood and anxiety disorder in general. Right. So it impacts the likelihood of using substances. But again, substances exacerbate mental health. And it also, there's some substance induced, like psychosis and things of that nature that comes from using substances.
Okay. Thank you so much. Sister Neville.
Yes.
What are some, you know, we hear about the COVID and we turn on the TV, we check our phones, we check check out social media, there's so much distressing and depressing news about this COVID. What are some mental health issues from your experience that can arise from this haze of hysteria that we see in our society, in our world?
The first one that comes to mind is definitely depression. In terms of mental health, I suspect that at the end of COVID-19 and when we are finally able to start interacting, the cases of depression is going to increase more than anything else. So we have depression. We're going to have, I suspect that we'll see an increase in anxiety and people being able to deal with stress. There'll be some mood disorders that's going to be there. And there's going to be personality dysfunctions in terms of how we relate to one another. You know, there's going to be interpersonal conflicts that, you know, people are going to have difficulty managing because now they have to come from isolation back into society.
My goodness.
And people are going to have a hard time in terms of adjusting to that type of lifestyle once again. So there's going to be a spike in interpersonal conflict in relations and depression, anxiety.
Thank you. Dr. Thomas, my question is, given what the our specialists have said, we know that these things are likely to happen. What would you suggest we do to prepare for this? Are there things that we can do to mitigate some of this if we see it happening to ourselves or to our loved ones?
Well, I mean, there's quite a bit of stuff that we can do because we are by nature social beings. Mm-hmm. And so we were not born to be in isolation. We were born to work together, live together, play together. And so that has been severely disrupted.
Yeah.
So what it does, how do you use technology to reach out to your family and friends at this point is very, very important. Your routines that you do is also very important. Regular exercise, limiting your meals and not overeating, because you can overeat if you're not careful. You can also oversleep because you figure I have no place to go. You sleep and sleep and sleep. And if you are a person already suffering from anxiety and depression, too much sleep would also help to increase that. So you need a routine, you need a schedule. And I normally say to each client or whenever I do a program, sit down if you're alone, sit down and work out a schedule. If you're with a family, sit down and work out a schedule with the family. If children are involved in that family, have the children be part of that schedule, and as well as have the children involved in what are the new rules, because there has to be new rules. And so you know from the time you get up in the morning, the things that you will do, take break, exercise, the meal, and of course, preparing healthy meals where necessary. So those things are very, very important to do. Now, going back there, sometimes people figure that to take a shot of brandy or a shot of alcohol or a beer or two might be a better way to ease their stress and anxiety that they're feeling. That is perhaps not the best way, because again, we know that old habits and new habits also die hard. And so you may be starting a habit that you cannot end, and that will now lead to you having to be committed or see an alcohol or drug counselor to deal with that added stress that you have brought upon yourself. Also, I want to warn folks who may be engaged in the smoking of marijuana. How much marijuana can you smoke? Because I've had clients who say to me, oh, when I smoke, it makes me feel mellow. It's, you know, it does better than the medication or something of that sort. And at the same time, I've seen folks who, because they smoke, it has exacerbated their mental illness to the point where they are hallucinating and creating real stress on the family itself. And these days they have these new strands of marijuana that sometimes do not agree with each person. And I have seen person who had no mental illness before, mental illness trigger by the marijuana or the type of marijuana they were using. So we have to be sensible about this thing. Yes, we are locked down. We know what it is for. I can tell you the good news is that this cannot last forever.
And Doc, and let me just say this, because a lot, I know most of the audience is a church setting audience. And when you speak to the issue of the consumption of alcohol and the use of marijuana, folks may be tempted to think, well, this doesn't relate to me because I don't do it. But there are people in church who actually do this. And of course, our audience, we know, will go beyond the confines of the church audience. But don't let us not fool ourselves. There are people in church who still wrestle with these. And so this is going to be very critical for them. And you seem to be saying that this could invite them to try to turn to some of these things as a way of coping. And what you said is so true, because recently a friend of mine who has been dealing with some serious stress came to me and said, well, you know, it was so tough on me. I ordered a Long Island, I can't remember the name of the drink, you know.
Long Island iced tea?
Yes, I don't know what was in the drink, but obviously.
It's a mixture of six liquors.
Watch yourself, Doc. People will think you do that stuff.
Hey, when you sit from where we sit, we hear a whole
I hear
lot
that.
Of things.
I'm just teasing. So, yeah, from what my friend told me, it was a very strong drink, and it had no effect on him except that it calmed him because of the grief and because of the stress and strain and the stuff that was happening. And, of course, we spoke about it because that could be a segue into continuing that stuff. Okay, so we want to be very mindful, and we want to look out for these things. What are some specific things we should look for that would suggest we are not coping effectively? Sister Neville, Sister Shakola, there are some things that you can tell me. Listen, I have a mental health issue. This stresses. I am not working. I'm not making any monies. I'm locked down in my home. What are some signs that you can suggest that I am not doing right functionally?
Well, Dr. Thomas spoke about routine. And one of the first signs that you're struggling, you're no longer interested in doing your routine. Remember, we're at home. And that unction to get up and take a shower, eat. You know, you may think that going 2, 4, 5 days without a shower is okay because you're not at home and no one is coming to your house. That itself can spiral you into depression, into anxiety, because you're no longer taking care of yourself. So you do have to take showers. You do have to cook that balanced, healthy meal on, you know, you do have to eat. You do have to, as safe as possible, get out and walk around your block and take in sunshine. But for you to sit on your chair and not want to move, there's concerns right there. So when you find yourself not wanting to do your routine, there's concern. When you find yourself not wanting to pick up the phone and reach out to family members, there's concern, because depression can be setting in, because now that loneliness and that fear that you may not be able to get out and socialize and interact with each other might be playing a strong part in you not wanting to pick up the phone and reach out to individuals. So there are signs when you stop taking care of yourself.
Mm-hmm. So when you skip our routine. Sister Shakola, do you want to add to that?
Yeah, I actually wanted to add something on the second question that you had about some mental health concerns that may arise as a result of like COVID. And one thing that comes to mind that I think people often don't talk about, especially minority populations, are eating disorders, right? Mm. Eating disorders come from a means of like trying to control your environment, right? And so when we think about COVID right now, it's a period of uncertainty for a lot of people. right? We can see how, especially now when you have lines at the grocery store that are like 2 hours long just to get like some milk, right? We can see how that can lend itself to even restricting, being restrictive with your intake, right? As a means of trying to deal with some of the anxieties that may come about as a result of this COVID, or even eating more, as Dr. Thomas kind of alluded to before. One thing that I think people often don't talk about too, because my primary work is in schools. So I am a school mental health consultant, which means that I help in terms of building competency in schools. And one of the biggest things that people have been discussing right now is trauma, right? And how that can manifest in the household. Primarily because, especially when we think about children, and this kind of builds off of the conversation we had last week in terms of how do we address abuse and how do we address just like suspected child abuse, right? So typically school is one of the first places where a child, where there's evidence to show that a child is experiencing some form of abuse. Now that we don't have school, right? Essentially children are going to be at home for a prolonged period of time with the perpetrator of their violence. The same kind of relates to domestic violence as well, right? And so as a result of COVID, there's gonna be a lot more trauma responses or just trauma behaviors that I think are gonna come about just because it's harder to kind of control our environment, given Ms. everything that's happening.
Now you struck a very important point here. Let me ask you a question. What are some things we can look for in a child that may be exposed to this trauma? What are some behavioral patterns that as adults we can look for?
Yeah, so one of those things is changes to behavior, right? Mm-hmm. So say for instance, if a child was typically very jovial before, and now a child isn't really interacting with others and just is kind of shying away, right? That is a big indicator that something is going on with that child, right? When it comes to, and it depends on what type of abuse you're talking about, right? And obviously we don't have the time to kind of like unpack all of this.
We should bring the team back to deal with that, okay? That's going to be on our agenda.
Okay. But another thing is like when children are kind of fearful, excessively fearful, right? Because I think kids generally want to please an adult, right? Because that's where we get our reinforcement from. So when a child is excessively fearful, in situations that really doesn't really compute to like that level of fear that we see. When a child is kind of, you know, nervous to being touched, for instance, like, you know, like you're even trying to like hug a child, for instance, and the child's kind of like shying away. But there's also more subtle things too, like even at home, like for instance, like oftentimes a big trauma response for children, especially like kids around like 5 to like 9 years old, where bedwetting typically isn't an issue at that point because kids typically are potty trained, that could be a big indicator of some form of trauma as well, right? Or just issues with toileting, just like a child who tends to be more constipated now all of a sudden, right? We talked, I think, about like the psychosomatic responses to stressors and trauma. And so that could also be a thing as well. But I also wanted to answer your question too. And I don't want to take up too much time, but I also want to answer your question too in terms of adding on to what Novelle and Dr. Thomas already mentioned in terms of like ineffective coping. One big one right now, I think, is impulsive behavior, right? And as a result as well as excessive worry, right? So you will find that, and I think oftentimes this is not even talked about as well, like impulsive shopping now, right? Like constantly on Amazon, trying to stock up on everything, right? And thinking, oh, I need to be prepared, but not realizing that, again, that's a way of trying to control our environment, right? In an unpredictable situation, but essentially that's not effectively coping with the stressors that we're experiencing right now, right? Another thing is also like difficulty concentrating, right? I mean, right now it's difficult to concentrate in general. Like I'm at home, I'm trying to work while also trying to like become a teacher to my child, right? And so that in of itself is just stressful, right? I work in schools and I have a newfound respect for teachers because I'm like, I don't know how they do this all day because I can't do it. But but just beyond the expected, right? Difficulties in terms of concentrating or just lack of interest in things. Like, you know, I love music, I love to sing. So if all of a sudden I'm not singing anymore, I'm not engaging in those things that I enjoy, right? That's telling me that something is going on and I'm not effectively coping with what I'm experiencing as well.
Thank you, Doc. Let me ask you a question. I had a friend of mine who suggests to me that her husband is now painting the inside of the house, and he has done it more than once. He has to be occupied. Mm-hmm. And I thought at first it was a strange thing, but she says, I'm so happy. I'm like, well, why would you be happy? She said, because he is a drug addict struggling with overcoming the tendencies. And a part of the coping mechanism for him is to paint the house as often as he can. What would you suggest? Because she asked me, what should I do? I was kind of stumped because I'm thinking I'd rather him paint than go back to using the drugs. But is that a good coping
mechanism? Well, it's obvious that he can't get the drugs either. And the problem is with someone repainting the house so many times. That's a cry out there for help. That person definitely has a problem. And so I would say to her, if he was seeing a counselor who used to help him, mental health or drug otherwise, then perhaps those are sessions that can still be had, because I'm still having session via video conference and telephone call, especially for my clients who feel that they cannot hold on any longer.
So these services have folks, are still intact?
They're still intact because you have folks who, and insurance now is allowing because of COVID, they would only allow before one or two sessions over the phone. But now because of what is happening with the distancing, they are allowing, they will reimburse you. They'll pay for the session. But it's very, very important because remember, you have folks who have been living paycheck to paycheck and now not sure when the next one will come. I've had a client the other day say, my phone bill is about to be cut off. I don't see any money. I don't have any money. No money's coming in. Just today, I had a session with one of my clients who said to me, I have not gotten my unemployment check right now. And I have a wife and a daughter at home, and we are running out of things. So those are serious things that stresses persons. And so, but having someone to talk to, I have one client last week said that he wanted an emergency session because he don't think he could hold on. And the fact that he's dealing with, you know, the father's debt, and he's dealing with a broken marriage and so forth, and all of the things that come in. And now you have a lockdown. And so these are things that are important. So I say that person needs, if you find yourself doing repeating stuff, you need help, because that is one of the compulsive behavior that Shakola, I think, spoke about. And so you are developing these behavior, but it does not help your situation in the long run. It only contribute a deeper sense. So, and then when you can't paint anymore, what next?
So my what question next? Is, I think you're answering my question, but let me just force it for someone who might be thinking. So if we have family members who are doing that, am I hearing you to say, we should not discourage this behavior and then try to get help, or discourage this behavior and try to get help?
Well, you should try to get help from the for the person, because it's not a behavior that will end well.
Yeah.
I mean, if you have painted over this room once and then you come back, you don't like the color, you want to paint it a different color again, then you come back, you paint it, you don't like that color. That is a serious issue of mental illness there.
So should the family taking member-
place? So, you should stop the activity seek help for what is going on, because there are obviously some underlining issues that are taking place that it's manifesting itself in. You're not painting a Picasso, you know.
True.
You're painting the same room 10 times different color in the same weeks, same days ahead. That has to be not a good situation, even for a family member who watching on. A wife might be glad that you're home and you're not using, but at the same time, she has to be worried that the bedroom has been painted
You're not coping
10
well.
Times, 10 different, you're not coping well. It's a blurry sign, not that this person needs help fast.
True. Sister Nabel, did you want to say anything on that issue?
With that issue also, what I would recommend is, mm-hmm. obviously, he's struggling with his substance abuse and not being able to have, whether it's access to his AA meetings or NA meetings, whatever form of support he may have had where he were able to go out to groups. There are online groups that individuals can turn to for those individuals who are struggling with substance abuse. There are NA groups online, there are AA groups online, so you can receive the help while we're practicing social distancing. You can, remotely access those online groups to have that support, because obviously it is a cry out for help and additional support. And oftentimes as family, we're not realizing that that's a cry for help in a situation like that. We're excited that the room is being painted, but that's his way of crying out and saying, I am struggling.
Thank you. And I really do appreciate that. We want to invite our Facebook audience, if you are with us, and we thank you for taking the time to be with us. If you have questions, feel free to type it in. It will get to us before we come to an end, okay? And we have about 15 more minutes, and we want to make the best of it. Sister Nabel, we're going to go right back to you. Since you ended on that one, let's start with you on this one. What are some practical ways? And we speak now to the Christian community, for the Christian community to deal with mental health issues. What are some practical ways from your expert opinion?
Well, started off with, talking about routine. So it's important to have a routine. But the other thing is, don't stop doing what you're doing. So if you are someone that is passionate about music and you have K-Love or Air One or all of your favorite gospel music on your phone, don't stop listening to that, because that is a form of helping you in terms of, creating that balance in the midst of everything that we're going through. I can't tell you to not, you have to continue praying. This is not a time to stop praying, especially for our faith community. But at the same time, when you pray, remember that your friends, you can call your friends who, and pray with them. They're looking for someone to reach out to them and say, let's pray. Continue with reading. This is the perfect time, if you have not picked up your Bible in how many years, the perfect time to pick up the Bible and start reading your Bible. So you've got to continue with reading. I can't stress it. Routine, stick to your routines, which means that if you have a prayer time, stick to your prayer time. If you have music, use music. It's a way of really calming the soul. And, if you love dancing, go right ahead and dance around your house. Dance. You're expending energy. It's a form of exercise, and it will keep the mind active. But you have to find a way to keep active and keep going. Don't allow yourself to shut down.
And these are some real practical ways that are powerful and impactful for the Christian community. Music, songs and hymns of praise, psalms, reading the Bible, keeping your regular routine, keeping a sound mind by the way you spoke and by the way you think. I remember last week, Sister Shikola was talking about your internal compass, because that is the lens through which we will engage reality. What do we have? What have we been experiencing? And these are the things that will allow us to gauge how we will interpret this. Sister Shikola, do you have anything to add to that before I ask you your question?
I definitely have something to add to that. And I also have something to add very briefly to the previous question. I kind of wanted to also point out the importance, because in drug treatment, we always talk about how substances are a means of coping, right? And so when you're trying to teach someone a new behavior, you cannot remove that coping mechanism without incorporating something new, right?
That's important.
And so, for the sister you were talking about before with her husband who's painting the house, right? That's his way of trying to cope with probably the triggers that he's experiencing right now. And so it would be helpful to help him to incorporate new coping mechanisms. We often call it like a toolbox, right? So you can't just utilize one coping mechanism, because after a while that does become a compulsive behavior, and we can become addicted to anything, right? Wow. It's not necessarily, I think oftentimes people think about addiction, they think about a substance or things of that nature, but we can become addicted to behavior, right? Just like, yeah. Exercising, people become addicted to exercising, for instance. So it'll be helpful to kind of help him to think about other ways of coping, but also like talking to him about what he's experiencing too, because clearly he's dealing and struggling with this a lot, and maybe feeling like maybe he can't talk about it, because oftentimes when it comes to substance use as well, right, there's a big impact on the family, and the person who's struggling with it may not want to add that pressure, right, by then talking about what they're experiencing as well, right? So engaging in dialogue, because sometimes we just need to get that out about the struggles and the stresses we're having. And that could also kind of help in terms of figuring out how to assist him in managing some of this more effectively as well, right? So I wanted to say that real quickly.
Yes.
Novelle kind of touched on most of them, but one thing is seeking counsel if we feel overwhelmed, right? Really not isolating. Given what's happening in the war right now, it's really hard not to in some instances, right? But kind of stretching ourselves a little bit and kind of reaching out to others and kind of continuing with our connections to make sure that we're effectively dealing with what we're going through. Journaling, right? Just like the ability to just write down what we're feeling is a really good tool. Because sometimes we don't even really know what we're feeling, right? We just know that we're feeling something. And not until we put pen to paper are we really able to really process and kind of make sense of what we're experiencing as well, right? And because sometimes even coming up with a new hobby, right? Oftentimes I hear people talk about all the things they want to do, but they don't have the time to do it, right? Oh, I want to explore photography. I want to explore dancing. I want to explore painting, right? This is the opportunity to kind of create that passion, delve into our passion projects that we're often talking about that we don't get the chance to do as well.
Thank you so much. Very probative. Doc, I am a child and I am being abused, but I'm happy to get a break to go to school. I can go to after class sessions. I could hang with my friends. Now I can't do that. Or I am an abused spouse and my abuser is with me 24/7.
Yeah.
What are some things as a victim that I can do to stay safe and to survive this? Because my abuser is with me 24/7. And anything I can do can trigger that. What would you suggest?
Well, David, unfortunately, even as church family, it happens to good church folks. And so brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so may be coming to church religiously, but is being abused at home. And figure that, let me just pray and one of these days God will fight my battle and finish this for me. But I like to say to clients and folks that love and prayer are action words. Mm. You pray and you get up and you have to put things into action, and the Lord will help those who help themselves. Now, it is very, very important that you come up with a safety plan. I would not advise you to just walk up and just confront or leave, but you should come up with a safety plan. A safety plan involving how you and your children, if there are children involved, are going to get out of this situation, because this situation may be getting worse at this point. And now you have to, maybe you can't scream anymore because the kids are home and you don't want them to know that you're getting beaten inside of the room. And so you have to hold your screen, or you're trying to protect your children. But there are still help available, especially if you're here in the New York area. Safe Horizon and other other places will take your call. A lot of my clients have gotten emergency apartments in order to move out from the abusive spouse so that they can be safe. I have given leave for folks from work so that they can leave work for the next 4 months or so to recuperate and don't have to see the abusive spouse. So these things happen. And we also wanted to know that, David, that abuse is not just physical. And some folks say if it was just physical, perhaps it would be better than the psychological, the emotional, the economic that you face. Because what happened, you have a lot of folks who cannot move because of the economic bind that they find themselves in. And they're not a breadwinner in any way. They contribute nothing to the economic development of the home, and they have no skill. So there's that fear to leave because how do I survive? So I say you can still get help. And there again, counselors can help you to put a safety plan together and how to stay safe, and not to aggravate the situation. I also want to say this as well, David, that according to the World Health Organization, more men are abused than women.
Wow.
However, men are more deadly in their response than women. So when we withhold washing, cooking, and anything that we used to do, it is a form of emotional and psychological abuse as well. When we withhold intercourse and sleeping girdle and tight jeans and so forth, those are also forms of abuse. So we have to really look at, why we are going through the things that we are going through. And if the matter cannot be resolved through counseling, I can say to you, I had a couple and they've been married for 4 years. There has been tremendous abuse, but the wife finally got the courage to call the police. Finally. And so she and the kids were taken out of the house. Now I got the husband, dealt with him with his anger management. And funny thing is that he and his wife has made it back together and they are having a better relationship than they had for the last 4 years.
Wow, that's a good outcome. That's a good outcome. There's a question. I'm very anxious. Oh, let me see what the question is. I want to see that question. Someone from the audience has asked a question. And Mr. Moderator, Trapp, could you pose that question again for me, please, so that I could see it? Are you with me? Could you pose that question again, please? Are you there, guys?
They're here.
Okay. Okay, I'm trying to see if I can get the question. Okay. Okay. The question is, I am very anxious and I have a problem controlling it. I have a family of four and I'm concerned for my kids, which I feel is the problem. I breathe heavy sometimes and can't sleep. How can I start to get help for this? I am very anxious and I have a problem controlling it. This person has a family of four and this person is concerned for her children. And she thinks this concern raises the problem of her anxiety, heavy breathing and lack of sleep. Go ahead.
I would want to say to her that she should definitely reach out and seek counseling from counselors, psychotherapists, mental health specialists. Because again, we often say that what we present as the problem is often not the problem.
Symptoms.
And there are those are symptoms, but the problem lies or started way before. I say to you, in a case in point, I had a client who was having anxiety from bereavement because a year ago her son was shot. And so she was taking that on and thought that it was her fault. And for 35 minutes, I could not get a word in. Every time she speaks, she was just crying. Finally, after I get to speak to her and to question her, you know what the problem was, David? Mm-hmm. The problem, not that she wasn't grieving for her son, but the problem is that she was in an abusive marriage. It was the worst form of abuse I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
That her phone rang while she was in my presence. And she quickly picked up and she said to me, "Doctor, I have to pick up on the first ring. And as a matter of fact, if he knows that you are a man that I'm coming to see, I can't come back to see you either." That is how serious it is. So oftentimes the problem that manifests, come forward, that we're presented with is not the problem. These anxieties are coming from other issues that are underlining. And a counselor would be able to work with you to see where, why you've been anxious, how often you've been anxious, and be able to work with you in sorting those feelings out and help you. Because sometimes cognitive therapy works well. I say some forms of forgiveness therapy works very well for these issues, and you might be shocked as to some of the things that comes out. Sometimes we have to go back to your childhood and ask you about things in your childhood that now manifest themselves that you have no link to.
Thank you, Doc. Sister Neville, Sister Shakola, do you want to respond to that?
Well, the individual who posed the question, I think they're doing the right thing. They've made the first acknowledging that their anxiety. We don't know where the anxiety is coming from. I can honestly say that they're probably, and even if you're not ready to speak to a counselor, you
somebody mute the background, please. I don't think it's you, Sister Neville.
Right. The individual mentioned that, they're having, they're breathing very deeply when they're sleeping, and there may be some weight issues there. They're concerned about their children. There are times when you acknowledge that you have anxiety, but you're not ready to take that step yet. But there are some other issues that have been presenting. So there may be concerns about health. There may be something there that's challenging that individual with their health. And due to that, that anxiety is increasing. So you may want to speak to your provider, whoever your medical provider is, about your concerns, because you may not be happy with the results that you've gotten. And you may have questions, but you don't know how to ask those questions. There are guidelines, there are ways in which you can engage your doctors in conversations about your health so that you get the answers necessary. So it's a very compact question, but like Dr. Thomas says, there are several things that may be triggering that individual's anxiety that needs to be sorted out. So yes, they've taken the first step in acknowledging it. The next step is, person may not be ready for counseling, but they can go to their medical providers. And if the person is ready for counseling, then whatever your insurance is, you can reach out to your insurance company to find out whether or not they have telehealth available at this time and what counselors are available within your immediate area that you can call and have sessions with so that you can start talking about something. The concerns there that's arising.
Thank you. Sister Shakola, I think you're muted. You should. And let me say this while you're unmuting. We are now at the 8:30 mark, and there is another ministry that should follow. So here's what we'll do. We'll give each of you 2 minutes to say your final word, and whatever you want to get in, here's your time. So we'll begin with Sister Shakola. We'll go with Sister Neville, and we'll end with Dr. Thomas. And then, so you have 2 minutes.
Okay. So I want to say that, you know, we often take, we often think that everyone has access to medical insurance and things of that nature. We live in a society now where that's not often the case for a lot of people, right? And so there are also a lot of free resources. There is a hotline called NYC Well that people can access if they, and it's completely free, and there's a licensed clinician on the other end. It's completely confidential. You can talk, text, or email. And that's just something that helps people in this time frame to kind of overcome some of their anxieties. I also want to say really quickly too that, you know, last week I alluded to kind of like how your thoughts impact how you experience things, right? Oftentimes with anxiety, it's a lot of the thought processes that we engage in, right? Most people tend to have rational or irrational fears, right? And I think a big piece for this individual who posed the question is kind of processing whether or not, is this something that is actual practical in terms of, is this something that the probability of this, my fear occurring, is 100%, right? That we know it's a rational fear, or is it that there are all these other possibilities and all these other probabilities as well? And so all those things are plausible, right? Oftentimes when it comes to anxiety, we catastrophize, which means that we think of the worst case scenario. We never think about the in-between or the other sides of it. We often think about the worst case. So something really quickly that this person can do is start to do some thought tracking, right? So what that means is just really writing down, what are my triggers? So the moments that I'm feeling most anxious, like what's happening for me right now, right? What am I thinking, right? That's kind of leading to some of this anxious feeling. And how do I reframe that, right? So instead of looking at it from this lens of, oh, everything is all doom and gloom, right? How can I shift my thinking in some ways where, even if it's not all the way positive, but at least it's more neutral. Okay.
Thank you. Is there anything else you wanted to add?
No.
Thank you so very kindly. Sister Neville, you got 2 minutes to tell us.
Well, Shakola basically took, basically said exactly what I was going to state, which is pointing everyone to that NYC Well number, which is a very good resource in terms of having to counselors.
I don't know how many people actually knew that. I never knew you could get free mental health care. Yeah. I would start to share that with my patient. It's NYC Health?
NYC Well.
NYC Well. And you don't have to have insurance to do this.
No.
From the first lady.
No. And it's not a long-term mental health care. It's more crisis. Something. They try to connect you to someone, but especially during this time frame, it's definitely useful. Yeah.
Thank you. Sister Neville?
Definitely useful. Like I said, a lot of support groups are online. You can definitely, if you need support around substance abuse, you can do AA online. You can find space online. You can find NA online. So a lot of the addiction services are online if that's needed. But all I can say is, if you've never journaled before, now is the best time to journal, as Shakola said, to put your thoughts to pen and paper so you can start looking at and tracking the way you're thinking. You can also do that for eating. You can also do that for exercising. Any concern you may have, if you put that issue to pen and paper, you can start seeing where some of your challenges are occurring so that when you are able to speak to someone face to face, you can give them evidence that, you know, you can say, I've been tracking myself for the past 5 weeks, and this is what I've come up with, and I need help. But
so Sister Neville, I'm hearing you to say the journaling is not just to do an activity to make yourself busy. There's a purpose to this thing.
Yes.
What are some of the things what are some benefits from journaling?
Benefits from journaling. You can actually find a way in the house where you have children who are not able to express themselves. Journaling is an excellent way in terms of communicating and being able to express yourself. So you can create a family journal where you talk about some of your concerns. So you're able to creatively express yourself. You know, for a person who's never had a passion for writing, you can create, you can develop a passion for writing through journaling, you know, because you're putting your thoughts out there and you're releasing some of the tension and the frustration that you're experiencing. But in family therapy, it's used a lot where, you know, a mom, or if there's a mom and a daughter, parents are having difficulty in communicating with their children, you create a family journal and say, you know, I miss you. You know, you write it, you leave it there, the child, and eventually you create conversations.
I got you. And I think also, Doc, as your final word, thank you so very kindly, ladies. I would love to have you back again with Dr. Thomas and myself when Shakola opened up a can of worms when she said there's so many different types of abuse. And I would very much like us to tackle that. Doc, you have the final word.
Yes, definitely a good program. And I say to folks who need help to seek help. For those who journaling is a good thing, but if you are a person who thinks you don't like to write, with everyone has a smartphone these days, and you could actually speak into the smartphone and it would write for you. It's one of the things that also I try to do clients in helping you to redirect your thoughts, because you can do that. And sometimes, as I think Shakola said correctly, once we attribute something to ourselves, normally we think of the worst form, and not that is something simple. We think that something has to be deadly wrong, you know, so we certainly do that. But we certainly should try to stay healthy. It's an opportunity to create new goals and objective while we have this. This might be a good, you may have been somebody who always wanted to do family prayer, but you could never get the family together at the same time for family prayer. You now have that opportunity, whether it's over breakfast or so. Now you can pray for the whole family, husband, wife, children, everybody is at home. And this is an activity that you can have done. You may have also wanted to show the girls how to crochet or to sew. But again, they've been busy with their lives and you've been busy with yours. This may be a great opportunity to create simple goals inside of the house that you can help it. If, you know, you may have wanted to take your dad to jail playing domino. Now might be a good opportunity to hone those skills and do that at home. So I say to you, do what you have to do to keep your mental health, because let me say this, your mental health is perhaps much more important than your medical health, because if your mental health is good, your medical health is likely going to be better.
My, thank you so very kindly, Dr. Thomas. And I think what you said augurs well with the word that says, as a person thinks, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And we shall guard well our heart. A lot of people read that text, but they don't understand. For out of the heart flows the issues of life. And so many adults are traumatized, having had their hearts traumatized as kids with abuse, with having the wrong home environment. And the issues of life that they face, and I'm sure you encounter them, the three of you in each of your specialties. And I don't know how you guys are able to do that every day, to go into that haze of brokenness and try to bring inspiration and hope, and you yourself not give in to the anxieties and the depressions and the abuse and the multiple expressions of dysfunctional health that you encounter. And we pray God for you. We thank God for your ministry, because I don't believe what you do is just a job. Whenever you have the power to influence the history, the reality, and the destiny of another human being, that is a powerful history and a powerful ministry. And I pray that God protects you, defends you, delivers you and your family, and keep you powerful, sharp, relevant, so that you can touch lives and the ripple effect may be a place in the eternal kingdom. Sister Horton, are you there for our final word?
Yes, I am.
Please take us home and take us away. And thank you for having us. And I want to say thanks on behalf of our lovely ladies and Dr. Thomas.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We want to thank this team for joining us this evening and for giving us valuable insights in human behavior and also informing us of supportive measures that can assist us in the process. And to you, our audience, thank you for sharing this session with us. We hope that you have been impacted by impact and somehow you have gained some insight and are better able now to create a balance in your life. Ladies and gentlemen, join us next week when another in the series of Impact will present financial strategies. That is financial strategies, another in the series of Impact. Ladies and gentlemen, keep safe.
Thank you.